Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byf here. Today we're going to be tackling the story of the Glykon. I've already made a number of videos on the stories and characters surrounding this ship, but today I wanted to go through the entire series of events that occurred on and around the ship before we arrived. This is a bit of an interesting story to see in Destiny, because piecing it all together really makes it feel like a massive murder mystery. We arrive well after the events of the Glykon have transpired, and we have to piece together everything, and our knowledge of the ship at first is very much incomplete. But thanks to the captain's logs that have been imbued with the memories of Katabasis, Calus, Gilgamesh, and the Locus of Communion, we get the more complete picture. I will refrain from reading all but the most important lore tabs in this video here for the sake of brevity, as there are about 14 or so lore tabs that are all relevant to this. So instead, I will simply go ahead and take you through the events as best we can tell, and as best we can tell, they all started with a hunter by the name of Katabasis. Katabasis is a hunter with very little patience for the city and the Vanguard. Hunters are often ones to wander and explore, and this can lead at least a few amongst their flock astray, just as warlocks are led astray by knowledge and titans are led astray by retribution. Katabasis found himself in the employ of Emperor Calus, who was easily able to tempt him and his ghost Gilgamesh into his service with a variety of exquisite and opulent prizes. However, one day Katabasis would be summoned to the Leviathan, and within its golden halls would be brought before Calus himself. Not the towering automatons that we've destroyed previously in the Leviathan raid, but a weak, old husk of a Cabal, the real Calus. Here, as Katabasis was forced to take in Calus's disgusting true form, Katabasis and Calus spoke of lies. Calus was irritated as he believed that he had been betrayed by the Darkness, which he saw as the final divinity of the universe. Now, for those of you that don't know, it's important to note that Calus is somewhat obsessed with the Darkness thanks to an event that occurred out in the depths of space when the Leviathan was being automatically piloted into nothingness thanks to Gaul. Why was it being piloted like this? Well, this was done so that after Calus was deposed in the Midnight Coup, he could not easily return to retake the Cabal Empire. But of course, in the process of the journey, something went wrong, and the Leviathan strayed into an area of what was supposedly called at the time being nothingness, a void that was not the void, something else, something other. And when Calus went out into the maelstrom of the Darkness in order to discover what awaited him, he returned, having seen something incredible. He returned proclaiming that he had seen the end of all things, and that the doom of the universe was approaching. From here, he declared himself to be its herald, calling it, and the Darkness, the Black Edge. From here, Calus believed that the universe was bound to end, and he foresaw himself as the Darkness's doomsayer, announcing this end to all peoples and all places. But Calus embraced in this moment what can only be described as the most incredulous form of nihilistic optimism, essentially saying that if the world is going to end, we might as well live in comfort and opulence until such a point as it does. Why not maximize the pleasure that we can all experience and embrace the inevitable truth of Darkness's ultimate victory? But in that dark place where he first found communion with the entity behind the Darkness, Calus believed that he had found an idol of sorts, as he was promised by the Darkness that the universe was going to end, and that they would uplift him in the silence amongst the stars at the end of the universe. However, the Black Fleet came and did not crush the worlds beneath its feet. The universe went on, and so Calus felt betrayed. He told Katabasis that gods had no cause to lie, and so as he put it, he would go to his so-called gods, the ones that he now called liars, and from them he would separate the truth. Calus intended to quite literally speak with the Darkness, and knowing his ambition, there was little that would stop him. From this moment, Katabasis was named as one of Calus's shadows, and was entrusted along with others within Calus's inner circle to help him accomplish this task. In order to speak to the Darkness, Calus would need a ship, and it was here that Katabasis was paired up with a Cabal centurion named Bartoran, who Katabasis affectionately nicknamed Barto, and a scion named Quinzig. The trio of them were instructed to infiltrate a Red Legion installation on Nessus, and to steal a Cabal carrier that was parked on the surface before detonating the facility's signal receiver dish, so as to allow them to not be traced until they had a chance to remove the locational anchor on board the ship they'd just stolen. This ship, the one that they would steal, was known as the Glykon Volatus, known more commonly just as the Glykon. In the process of taking the Glykon, Barto was tasked with setting the explosives on the signal receiver, while Katabasis and Quinzig prepped the Glykon for launch. It's here that we actually learn that Quinzig is a member of the Scion Conclave, as she is able to interact with another Scion and convince her to leave the ship, for the good of overall plans still to unfold. In the process, the other Scion, named Yrix, retreated. And it's interesting because this Scion Yrix is actually the one who was testing the light-suppressing devices in the EDZ, a series of events that saw a witless Titan suffer a final death. All of this is noted down in the lore tab of the palindrome. This is an interesting aside because it shows that the Conclave is a network that truly does span every single one of the Cabal factions, be they the Red Legion Remnant, Keitel's refugees, or Calus's loyalists. Barto, Quinzig, and Katabasis were successful in their operation to steal the Glykon Volatus, and were then tasked with the less than enviable job of gathering the raw stock of test subjects that would be required for Calus's experiment of communication with the darkness, which would be performed aboard the Glykon. These test subjects, this raw stock of new recruits to Calus's cause, would not be Cabal or Scions. They would need to be creatures of darkness with minds of rot and decay that were already dead. One such creature of this nature exists in abundance in Sol, the undead fallen of Fikral the Fanatic and the late Aldrin Sov, the Forsaken Prince of the Reef. They are better known today as the Scorn. This represents an interesting case for our questions surrounding communing with paracausal entities, and particularly the darkness, as it seems as though it's more and more likely that it is easier for some that are dead to commune with the darkness, and that the darkness might have a simpler time communing with us when it is able to manifest through those that are dead. Barto and Katabasis, who gathered the Scorn from across Sol, would focus their operations around where the Scorn were most plentiful, on the tangled shore of the reef. When these test subjects were returned to the Glykon, Katabasis couldn't help but wonder what was being done to the Scorn, why they were being used, and what they were going to be used for. Quinzig, who was running the laboratory aboard the Glykon, initially brushed off Katabasis's concern. But at the mention of Barto and the other Cabal, who were also putting their lives in danger to recover these test subjects, Quinzig acquiesced. She led Katabasis over to a tank filled with what looked to be dark ether. Within, drowning but very much still active and acting on its impulses, shrieking in a mute, rolling, grotesque manner, was one of the Scorn. Quinzig told Katabasis that these Scorn were linked psychically just like the Scions were, but they required an overarching hive mind to give them purpose. Without the Barons of the Tangled Shore to lead them in any way, these Scorn were left with simply the last remaining thought on their mind, which gave them purpose. That last thought simply being, kill for Fikral. It appeared, though, that through experimentation, Quinzig and Calus's other scientists had discovered that through dark ether drowning and the particular inscribing of runes within the brain, these Scorn could be opened further to the darkness. Through preparation, the Scorn would be used as a vessel for the darkness to inhabit, so that Calus might be able to commune with it. It should be noted that this is not the first time that this method of communing with the darkness has been used. Most notably, in the Books of Sorrow, Oryx the Taken King is noted to have communed with the darkness after defeating an enemy species known as the Tai, of a world known as Tai Shabirth. After this victory, the Books of Sorrow records the following event. Oryx went down into his throne world. He went out into the abyss, and with each step he read one of his tablets, so that they became like stones beneath his feet. He went out and he created an altar, and he prepared an unborn ogre. He called on the deep, saying, "I can see you in the sky. You are the waves which are battle, and the battles are the waves. Come into this vessel I have prepared for you." And it arrived, the deep itself. Whether Calus knew about these passages in the Books of Sorrow or not, it appears that he is also looking to see communion with the darkness take place via the use of a vessel endowed with dark power. The Glykon was then flown to a gravity anchor off of Phobos, and there Calus boarded the Glykon along with his scribe Umsot and a retinue of his personal subjects. Together, that retinue brought with them a procession, and at the head of that procession was an artifact of terrible hive power. The artifact was, of course, the Crown of Sorrow. This was previously worn by Galran and was filled with the corrupting influence of Savathun, but thanks to the adjustments of Calus's scientists, it had been recovered. Savathun's influence had seemingly been scrubbed, and it had been repurposed to open the mind of whoever wore it to the darkness. It was here that Calus's first communion with the darkness would be attempted. The series of events proceeded as follows. This page is blighted with mold and the imprint of a memory. The words seep experience into your open mind, through the eyes of Calus the Cacoethes. A crowd has gathered to stand with me, their emperor, soon to be so much more. Amsot spread word of my arrival, and they clamored to be the first in my presence in the viewing chamber. I spot the guardian and his little light as well, an extra morsel of bait. The ghost watches while the guardian resigns to the rear. Pity. All come to view the zenith of my labors. I am omnipresent. Every angle that can be seen is seen by statues at every corner. My plated carriage monitors the crown for aberrations. It is adorned with gold from the castellum for my viewing. I paid many lives to pry it free from hive clutches, but it bent most agreeably. Its ability to bridge minds and bring them to submit. I see my tributes, scorn, gibbering, nonsense in unison, lashed and plugged to the crown, a thorn-made tool in my brilliance. My daring counselors anchor their psyches and prepare to begin the communion. Greatness is before us. These watchers, I shall thrill them. I clap four monumental pairs of hands. Let it begin. I turn all my gaze to the chamber's expansive viewing window as shutters unveil the grave of Mars. Tendrillic bands of phasing darkness spiral from the anomaly's core, enrapturing all of me, beckoning into the depths of its core with whispers like hooks through nervous flesh. I gape into the stimulating writhe. Yes. My counselors place their hands on the crown and focus cognition through it. They pry open the Scorn's collective synaptic pathways and sew them into the fabric of the anomaly's mimetic sphere. The Glykon strains against the pull. Velocity surges forward to the anomaly. The surrounding reality tears away. We hold, suspended before the writhe. It fills all sight, nothing just beyond the bend. Time ceases, and the cosmos arcs to accommodate my will. Now. Delight in me. I emulated all of me in your image, stretched my mind to live through so many. I reaped the pleasures and experiences of every vessel. But despite my sundry perspectives, I still only see through my own eyes, and I want more. I peer into the dark nothing. You are oblivion. Not a destruction, but a melding of all that has come to pass. I wish to become as you are, to gorge on existence, to collect your promise to elevate me. My laughter is wild, all of my forms transfix on the swirling anomaly. Look upon me. The cosmos bends and snaps as I stand, returned to my feeble reality. Ignored again. The scorn shriek nonsense in unison. It drowns out of the whispers. It is all any of me can hear. I reach out, as you showed me when last we met. I split open each scorn mind from my carriage, searching for you. Nothing. Every time. So I tear open their bodies, fitfully pulling limb from socket, mind from skull, scouring them for your presence. I search until the shrieking can only be heard from distant pens. I meet the eyes of each crew member who would not look away. In them, I see it. You, peering back from behind the tension. An observer. Calus' first experiment with the Scorn and his first attempt to commune with the darkness was a failure. He tore the wilting bodies of the Scorn apart, and ultimately, even though this was a moment where it was a setback, it would be a moment that defined the experiments going forward. This would be the formula that all of them followed, and it was most certainly not the end of Calus' work to commune with the darkness. Many failures would be seen and many adjustments would be made until at last, a breakthrough. The experiments of the Glykon's crew eventually centered around a single large Scorn that would come to be known by us as the locus of communion. With this, a series of experiments were conducted on that Scorn as it would become the center of the studies of the Glykon's crew. One day, the chamber was prepared, and once again the crew made ready for the Scorn to be linked to the Crown of Sorrow. But this time, the Scorn and the Locus were linked into the Crown's systems. And from here, everything changed. This page is blighted with mold and the imprint of a memory. The words seep experience into your open mind. Through the eyes of Katabasis. Calus' tomb carriage overlooks the viewing chamber once again. All his forms stand around a garish mass of metal and apprehension. The crown, as he called it. Fewer crew members attend this communion after so many failed attempts. Gilly and I stand above a host of chattering carcasses. Plugs and cables run from them into the flesh of an ether-logged Scorn beneath an ugly crown. The gold from the castellum is flush with tarnish, stemming from some kind of lichen that had burrowed its way into the precious metal adornments since the last communion attempt. I thought gold doesn't stain, I say to Gilly. It's an expression of purity. Like the light? I grunt. Gilly fixates on the crown, on the viewing window, and the depth beyond. Barto takes a spot next to me and leans against the railing. Are all guardians ruled by uncertainty? Counselors approach the crown. Barto, in my experience, people who are too sure of themselves tend to die. The counselors place their hands to the crown, and suddenly, I am greatly aware of this room's stillness. Our tilt. Barto raises his voice over the intensifying chatter. Your ghost speaks to the Scorn as much as they can. Curious, that's all. Looking for an angle? Something we can use? Ain't that right, Gilly? I ask, trying to hide my suspicion. Gilgamesh says nothing, iris frozen ahead as the viewing curtain completes its retraction. Velocity surges forward to the anomaly, tearing away the surrounding reality. The sound of Calus' feverish, multifold laughter drowns the hull's groans for mercy. It's different this time. Not a passage. It's a wall. We crash hard, but not all at once. It's a steady, tumbling impact, always down. The cosmic bands bend around us and shudder as they're drawn into thin, bright needles of diminishing relevance. Peripheral obliteration mainlined and burnt through. The space between each needle of light expands until it is. The transition is like a reluctant membrane, a depth of souls frozen over and wailing. The ice grinds against itself at the elliptic barrier between form and expression. We cross, sunless, adrift on empty currents with no direction. Where's the Emperor? The next moments recorded in the sodden memory of the Glykon's captain's log come from the perspective of the locus of communion, a scorn that when it was once an elixni, may have been called by the name of Acris. The locus of communion's thoughts are recorded here, in the moment where a strange entity overtook it. This page is blighted with mold and the imprint of a memory. The words seep experience into your open mind, through the eyes of an empty vessel. Dormant, bound, threat, storm outside, rain, soft thirst, flashes show shapes, shapes I know. Gentle whispers reach from me, to all, as father, as Fickrel, barons, Kells, gone. Another voice. Pressing. Fear and confusion. No. The mind beneath this one screams to the surface. Nothing. Scorn. A son. Fallen. Elixni. King. Acris does not bow. Arise, commands the voice buried in whispers. Acris does not bow. But Acris is dead. Peeled away. The spine of the Glykon breaks, its vertebrae now interchanging. Scorn howl to herald the crossing into nothing. Through the locus, they hear the whispers and obey. Meet salvation. Thus, the scorn from the tangled shore all rose and came to life. Plunging into the anomaly as the ship had done meant that the entire structure of the Glykon was rearranged, leaving the crew disoriented, cut off from each other and confused. It also meant that the Scorn were released from all the holding pens and containment areas aboard the ship, and now were free to run rampant. Katabasis, Quinzig, and Barto, and any others mounted an effective resistance to the foul monstrosities at first, but eventually, they would be overrun. They tried sending a team to detonate the Glykon's core. Scorpius turrets were deployed throughout the ship to try and slow the tide of Scorn, and incendiary teams were dispatched to burn the Scorn down to ashes where they fell. But all of these measures would be in vain. The Glykon was trapped in the grip of the anomaly, and periodically, the ship would rearrange its orientation internally into impossible and unpredictable patterns, meaning that the different teams across the Glykon continually were being cut off and isolated from each other, being forced to deal with the Scorn by themselves. And if that wasn't enough, every time there was a shift, the Scorn would resurrect and fight once more. The numbers of the Cabal and Katabasis were starting to dwindle. Hope was running out. In a desperate gambit for survival, Barto, Quinzig, Katabasis, and 15 Cabal survivors would gather after having coordinated a plan to try and leave the anomaly. Quinzig had stated that she could raise the Glykon from the anomaly's grasp if she was able to sever the connection between the anomaly and the Crown of Sorrow. Quinzig's sacrifice for such an effort would be great, and success was not guaranteed. As the Cabal gathered around the crown, they took up defensive positions. Quinzig prepared to attempt to sever the crown, and the Scorn began their assault. Those final moments transpired as follows. Velocity surges backward into infinity, tearing away the surrounding reality. We stand in nothing, 17 defenders back to back around Quinzig and the crown. The shrieks grow louder. And through the winds of bending steel, the trembling flesh of Scorn pour into the nothing with us. Slug rifles unleash a salvo in all directions from behind a handful of phalanx shields, tearing line after line of Scorn down with explosive force. Incendiors step forward to cremate the remains between volleys. I add my gun to line, dropping raiders before they can align shots on our ring, and sling void wall grenades to stem the flood. Quinzik screams, straining to sever the link as the Glykon thrashes against dark waves. Black fire scalds her hands as nothing twists around us. We fight until the floor is lined with dead scorn and empty magazines. The shrieking recedes, scraping metal echoes through the viewing chambers as a wave of darkness tremors through the Glykon. Every unburnt scorn seizes and begins to reconstitute. Soldiers panic and fire into heaps of writhing bodies, hoping to stop the process. In the chaos, lightning rips through the air, cutting through three legionaries and rupturing an incendiary tank. The blast kills seven. The circle tightens. We return fire in the direction of the lightning and are met with two fetid abominations. They burst into the chamber and rear back with crackling fists. I charge one, slipping into the void to draw blades from their sheaths. Barto snatches a phalanx shield resting at his feet and challenges the other. Its bolts break on the shield. Our remaining guns harry them with slugfire until we close the gap. I cut through hands and heads, then pivot to see Barto driving his shield into the other's face. Quinzig cries out. I spin on my heel and see her engulfed in black flame and the cosmos racing around us. She spreads her pain to us to hold on a few moments longer. To no avail. I look back to Barto, deeper past him, in the nothing. To the hulking silhouette dragging a flaming sensor. And I know, this is where we die. The attempt to wrest the Glykon from the anomaly's clutches had failed. Quinzig, Barto, and all the other remaining Cabal were dead and gone. Only Katabasis and his ghost Gilgamesh remained, and from this point on, Katabasis made every effort to survive by using the smuggler's holes on the Glykon, where he had stashed supplies and go-bags. Eventually, though, after what must have been months, these supplies began to run dry, and he began to fall to starvation over and over again. He went as far as to tell Gilgamesh not to revive him until there was a solution or someone had come to rescue them, so that he didn't have to die over and over again in the grasp of hunger. But eventually, after so long in the coiling darkness of the anomaly, Gilgamesh failed and enacted a final choice that would doom its guardian. This page is blighted with mold and the imprint of a memory. The words seep experience into your open mind through the eyes of Gilgamesh. I linger on the corpse of my once guardian. I've hidden his shame for so long. I believed it was my obligation to be the warmth when his fire died, but now I see that obligation was a leash to keep me tied to life. It is a cold, coiled, choking reality, and I will hang gasping from it no more. I see the truth the whispers had offered. I saw it in every moment suffered aboard this vessel, a microcosm of violence extrapolated to the world beyond, with only one escape. Soon, Katabasis would know it too. Scorn onlookers surround us. I raise Katabasis. Gilly? Katabasis kneels before me, his rifle beside him. What is this? A way out. I won't carry you anymore. You're abandoning me? Katabasis looks to the scorn, his rifle, his ghost. No. No longer. Not his. Not the traveler's. Not anyone's. I sacrifice everything to keep you moving forward. Guided you to every power you needed to survive. I share the truth he wants to forget. And for what? It never ends anything. There's always more. The scorn encroach across disjointed walkways. Katabasis sinks. You said you wouldn't. You, the traveler, you've kept me trapped in this death knell. Now it's time to set us free. What does that mean? His words, like stone weights. Sever our light, or they'll rip you apart for 1,000 lives. I gesture to the scorn. You wouldn't. Your deaths are heavy, Katabasis, but I'll bring you back as many times as it takes for you to learn. He does not understand. You think I don't feel pain? You think I don't suffer while you're hiding in your limbo? Katabasis lurches forward. I did everything you asked me to. You left! I shout. You left me here. You left me in the city. You made me turn away from the Traveler. We're like the Scorn in those tanks, drowning in panic, confusion forever. You did that. The city was burning, and I wanted to live. Everything was so we could live. He still didn't see it. This place is no different than Sol, a barrel of blood. There's no reason to go back. Now the light is burning. We can survive this. Katabasis holds out his palm for me. Please. I don't want survival, Katabasis. I drift away from him. I want salvation. It got to you. Katabasis sobs weakly, his epiphany complete. You can end this for both of us. It's your turn to sacrifice, I offer. Everything you say is a lie. Katabasis grabs for his rifle, lever to action, shot to nothingness, ghost to dead memory. Katabasis managed to make it back to the bridge with his weapon, the dead man's tail, before finally falling for the last time. The circumstances of his death are unknown, but the strange flora that dots the Glykon's derelict wreck now leeches his body for sustenance like it does with all the others of the Cabal, and Katabasis became nothing more than a gruesome effigy of this doomed ghost ship. The Glykon's crew were no more. They were slaughtered to a man. However, it appears that Katabasis was not completely without hope at the end. We picked up and intercepted a distress signal received in a Red Legion firebase in the EDZ. This would eventually lead us to the Glykon's coordinates and would set us and Osiris on the path to investigate the Glykon. From there, we would defeat the locus of communion, and over a period of 3 months, we would return to investigate the derelict vessel each week. As we worked our way through the ship, we discovered at long last the final smuggler's hole, and within, we rediscovered the Crown of Sorrow. That is the story of what happened aboard the Glykon before we arrived. If you want more analysis of what we found during our investigation, as well as everything else, I recommend that you go ahead and look up all the videos I have on the Glykon in the Season of the Chosen playlist. It's all a lot to get through, but trust me, it's worth knowing the secrets of this dark place. It will not only serve you well to know it, but also to serve as another warning against the dangers of the darkness and its power. But perhaps there are yet more secrets that can be gleaned from the Glykon. And if so, perhaps they hint to the darkest lore that we have ever uncovered. The ability to commune with the entity behind the shadows. But that's all from me for now. I do hope you enjoyed this rather long video. If you did, go ahead and leave a like, and also let me know your own thoughts down below in the comments section. And if you want more Destiny content, go ahead and hit subscribe, and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. But as per usual, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Horodacia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.